First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace, you back once again with Dr. Alim ElBey. All right, we're going to get into some information here in which that is breaking news, actually. And basically what it's about is the Pope has actually, Pope Benedict allegedly will go to jail for 25 years for his role in crimes against humanity. So this is breaking news. And matter of fact, the article goes in and talking about final verdict is rendered in the first common law court case against the Vatican in Canada for genocide, Pope, the Queen, and Canadian Prime Minister are found guilty of crimes against humanity and sentenced to 25 years prison terms. The court ordered them to surrender by March the 4th or face citizens' arrest, and this is according to Brussels, Belgium. Now, this is where it took place at in the international court. Now, what it goes on to say is that Pope Benedict will go to jail for 25 years for his role in crimes against humanity, and the Vatican's wealth and property is to be seized, according to today's historical verdict of the International Common Law Court of Justice. All right, the Brussels-based court handed down a unanimous guilty verdict for its citizens' jury and ordered the citizens' arrest of 30 defendants commencing March 4th in a court order issued to them today. Now, this is the reason why they was wondering about this asteroid in which that was coming through, in which that was supposed to be the wormwood, in which that is mentioned in the book of Revelation, based on not just the book of Revelation, but also on the prophecies of Malachi, as we spoke about before. So here it is, showing forth is that the real reason behind why he had to step down also is not because of just the prophecy or correlation to the prophecy, but because of those crimes in prophetic times. So here it says that the verdict read in part, we, the citizen jury, find that the defendants in this case are guilty of two indictments That is, they are guilty of committing, and abetting and aiding crimes against humanity and of being part of an ongoing criminal conspiracy. The jury ruled that each defendant received a mandatory 25-year sentence without parole and have all their personal assets seized. All right, that's very interesting. The court went on to declare in its order number 022513-001, the defendants are ordered to surrender themselves voluntarily to peace officers and agents authorized by this court, having been found guilty as charged. The defendants have 7 days from the issuing of this order until March the 4th, 2013, to comply. And after March 4th, 2013, an international arrest warrant will be issued against these defendants. The guilty parties include Elizabeth Windsor, Queen of England, Stephen Harper, the Prime Minister of Canada, and the head officers of the Catholic, Anglican, and the United Church of Canada. A complete copy of the verdict and the court order and the list of defendants is enclosed actually on a YouTube link. So if you can go to YouTube, you can actually pull up this information and get the complete list. The guilty verdict follows nearly a month of deliberation by more than 30 sworn citizens juries of the 150 case exhibits produced by court prosecutors. These exhibits detail irrefutable proof of a massive criminal conspiracy by the defendants, institutions to commit and conceal genocides of generations of children in a so-called Indian resident school across Canada, and none of the defendants challenged or disputed a public summons issued to them last September, nor did they deny the charges made against them or offer counter evidence to the court. Their silence, their silence told me a lot. Why wouldn't innocent people defend them on their own reputations when accused of such horrible things? Commended one jury based in England. These crimes are aimed at children and were a cold and calculated plan to wipe out Indians who weren't Christians. And the defendants clearly are still covering up their crimes. So we felt we had to do more than slap their wrists. The whole reign of terror by state-backed churches that are above the law has to end, because children still suffer from it. All right, the article goes on to say that the court's judgment declares that the wealth and the property of the church responsible for the Canadian genocides to be forfeited and placed under public ownership as reparation for the families of more than 50,000 children who died in the residential schools. To enforce this sentence, the court has empowered citizens in Canada, the United States, England, Italy, and a dozen other nations to act as legal agents armed with warrants and peaceful occupy and seize properties of the Roman Catholic, Anglican, and the United Church of Canada, which are the main agents in the deaths of these children. So, see, the Pope definitely thinks that he is above the law, because his edicts has caused the death of more than 300 million people on the planet over just the last 500 years, right? It says these sentences gives a legal foundation and legitimacy to the church occupation that it has already begun by victims of church torture across the earth. Commended Kevin Arnett, the chief advisor of the prosecutor's office who presented its case to the world. And you can go to www.itccs.org, November the 6th and January the 30th posting. The verdict of the court is clearly that these criminal church bodies ought to be legally and practically disestablished. Right now, remember that was based on the prophecies in which that was stated, is that is going to be the last pope is going to be a so-called black pope, and of course we know his name is Peter Turkson, right, the son of the Turk, all right. In other words, a so-called Moor, and after that, it will be the end of the Catholic Church, and this is what is going on. We've seen the end of the Catholic Church right now. Basically, what has happened is that the Christ has arrived upon the planet. We're talking about Christ consciousness with those within those who are ready. We're not talking about just one individual. But here it is. It says, including the Canadian Prime Minister, the Queen of England, and to Joseph Ratzinger, the retiring Pope Benedict, who is avoiding arrest within the Vatican after suddenly resigning 2 weeks ago. The citizens' arrest of these and other defendants will commence on March the 4th if they do not surrender themselves and their assets as per the court order. These actions will be filmed and posted at here in the coming weeks, along with further updates for the court and its citizens' agents. All right? Matter of fact, it goes on that it says that please see the Occupying U2 video issued by the Central Office, the International Tribunal into Crimes of Church and State. All right? And this was what was just posted just 2 days ago. That is fascinating to me that they have the former Pope, who is now, as we know, who just resigned within the last 2 weeks, the Queen of England, the Canadian Prime Minister, as well as others. They have actually stated that they have committed crimes across Canada against humanity, against the world. Now, that means that if we can go after these particular people, if there's an international court of common law court, in which that was able and is able to go against these people, then we must also do so against the United States, all right? Against the United States, this so-called corporation for the deeds in which they have done against us. This is obviously the same court that we need to take this to in Brussels, Belgium. So that's just to keep something in mind as we continue to go forth with human rights and their violations of indigenous people and the genocidal acts in which that have commenced against the indigenous people and the aboriginal people here within the Americas, i.e. us, the Moors, as well as also our brothers, who come up under the banner of Native American / Indian. All right, so we know that we need to definitely band together in order to get that process going. Now it seems as if we know the court in which that we definitely need to go to. Not the United States Supreme Court. We won't get justice there. We know this for a fact. All right. Only thing they will do is tell you that they agree with the lower courts. That's it. All right. So we have to begin to start taking on in class action suits at this exact same court here, which is the International Common Law Court, all right, in Brussels, Belgium. This is what we need to be doing. All right, I'm getting ready to bring on my co-host. Brother L, are you here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Peace and love, God.
Peace and love, brother. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. Great. How yourself?
We doing well. We doing well.
Okay. I've listened
to
you.
Yeah,
when
you talk about the events in which that we just talked about here.
Yeah, I didn't know he was being convicted of any crime. The Pope, I thought it was just the energy alone that he couldn't deal with.
Yeah, well, that's also was part of it. That's part of the prophecy of Malachi, in which that stated that that the Pope, prior to this last pope, which of course is going to be this black pope, as they refer to him as, the African pope, who is known as Peter Turkson.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, like I said, I never heard of an African by the name of Peter Turkson. So,
no, I haven't
that is some English, / Turkish, name, reformation
exactly.
There for African.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Yeah, so they're getting ready to lock him up, huh?
That's what it said. We're going to see what's going to happen by March the 4th. We will see within the next 7 days, within the next week here, what will actually take place. You know, how serious this actually is. You know, because if this actually is true and this is and this hits the mainstream, it will have to hit the mainstream. They would not be able to hide this information much longer.
Wow.
You know, and like I said, if that is the case, then we need to do the same thing against those here. We're talking about the Rockefellers and the Rothschilds and so forth and so on. We need to do the same thing against the bankers, since they done went after the Pope and Queen Elizabeth, you know, who, of course, we know the Pope owns, you know, basically the land. I mean, he's basically the head trustee over the land of what we now refer to as the United States.
Right.
You know, and Queen Elizabeth is the head of the Social Security Administration here in the United States. So, based on that alone, there will have to be some restructuring, you know, based on that information. And so, being that they have been found guilty, and the peace citizens are stating that they are going after them by March the 4th, man, this is deep. We will see what it definitely take place here.
It really is. Man, I never heard nothing like that before, especially about with the Pope. Is he Polish or German or?
Yeah, he's German or Austrian.
Didn't he serve with the SS?
Yes, he did. But
I
so did the
so.
Pope. But so did the former Pope too. The Pope before him supposedly was the one who was the salesman for the tear gas for the chambers during the Jewish Holocaust, as they claim.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
That I didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I know this one right here, he was with the SS. Right. With the SS. You know, he was a Don Hart SS officer. And I was wondering, that's not strange, because the Vatican Church, the Roman of Rome, always had a strong connection with Nazi Germany anyway.
Right. Well, see, that correlates too back to this last year when we were speaking about the child sex ring, you know, in which that reveals unspeakable acts of the so-called power elite.
Mm-hmm.
The Vatican is behind that. You know, the Vatican is behind you know, that information as far as these children. Matter of fact, one of the most difficult things to convey to people who are relatively new to the information is that, you know, it appears in that so-called alternative media that it is just how diabolical the controlling elite really are. You know, and so when you start studying, you know, people who, you know, can seem to accept that the world is ran by a bunch of ruthless bankers, you know, of course, you know, the so-called Illuminati, you know, or perhaps they realize that the president and national leaders are merely puppets for the corporate interests, or perhaps they even have come to grips with the fact that the elite are willing to destroy nations and people to consolidate power and form the so-called one world order, you know, poison the planet with the depleted uranium. And, yes, even poison the food supply with GMOs, definitely. So people, you know, can definitely, you know, bear witness to that. But according to the missingkids.com, 800,000 children under the age of 18 go missing every year globally. So that's more than 2,185 children per day.
That's a lot of people.
The hotlines receive an average of, like, 580 calls per day to the point in the last quarter of the 2012. And about 3.5 million calls since the organization inception in 1984.
Wow.
You know, so it's clearly an epidemic of staggering proportions. So when we read about Fritz Springmeier or Todd Collins or David Icke, you know, in which they began talking about this information over, you know, 20 years ago, about 20 years ago, and in particular, Todd Collins, who was speaking about it 30, 40 years ago, about an organized pedophile ring and mind-controlled sex slaves, that is no joke, you know, with the highest levels of society. You know, and most readers, you know, would try to dismiss that information, but they can't. And the Vatican, as far from my research, is behind that.
Hmm.
You know, this is the reason why the Pope was trying to hide the child molestations of the bishops throughout the country, throughout the world.
Hmm.
You know, and he even justified, you know, the child molestation. Is that something that the Vatican or the Catholic Church has been doing for eons or for years?
Hmm.
He actually stated that, paraphrasing, of course, but that was stated.
Yeah, well,
you know,
see, a lot
you
of
get
people talk-
David Icke's book, The Biggest Secrets, he details that a number of U.S. and U.K. political leaders, you know, basically was dealing with these scandals, you know, as far as, you know, dealing with these children. Matter of fact, he named several other.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, he named several, I guess you would say, children, nurseries, you know, in which that he made mention of those various children nurseries in which that dealt with pedophilia. You
well,
know,
some of
is right, the all various orphanages or child homes also is made mention. You know, so there's a lot going on here, and it seems as if the Vatican is behind all of this. You know,
there's a lot of Hollywood
on,
celebrities behind that as well.
Well, the celebrities definitely come in, you know, at the behest of, you know, being known, as well as also political figures, you know, so.
Mm.
But, I mean, I remember back in the 90s, actually the 80s, the late 80s, Ronald Reagan, you know, I believe it was in his second term, and the first term of George Walker Bush, Daddy Bush, they got busted for a sex ring right there going to the White House.
Wow.
You know, we spoke about this before, too, here on the radio show. In particular, last year when we were speaking about these children, the sex ring slaves, as well as also the mind control agents, Manchurian candidates, and so forth and so on.
Right, right.
You know, a matter of fact, DynCorp is responsible for recruiting and training, deploying civilian peacemakers and police trained in 11 countries, including Haiti, Bosnia, Afghanistan, and Iraq, from the for the Department of State. And based on what it says, but one group really shows the scope of child sexual slavery and abuse, and every vile activity imaginable, and that is DynCorp.
Man, that's one of the major corporations
exactly.
In the world.
Right. It says that DynCorp is part of the largest network of child prostitution involving international aid workers.
And these part of the people that control and runs the world.
Exactly. And matter of fact, the whistleblower was Ben Johnson and Kathleen Blockerville were both fired after attempting to stop the DynCorp employees and supervisors engaging in sexual acts with children. These children have been purposely kidnapped from other regions to serve as sex slaves. You know, so these are the things in which that is going on. Matter of fact, there was a more recent whistleblower in which that came from WikiLeaks, in which that talked about in Afghanistan that the DynCorp threw boy parties for new Afghan police recruits. Right? And that the explosive DynCorp funded by the United States taxpayer is perhaps the supreme example of the predator stalking this planet.
Ain't that wicked?
Yeah.
Man, that's wicked.
And
taxpayers don't even know where anybody is.
Right. This is what it says. Here is Donald Rumsfeld stammering through an attempt to explain the continuous governmental support for DynCorp. An excellent two-part report, Child or Children Under Attack, about the systematic abuse and cover-up, you know, can be actually investigated. You know, I mean, we're looking at individuals, you know, in suits, crowns, uniforms, who are literally blood drinking psychopaths.
That's real.
You know? Right. So these are the things in which that is going on in the news right now as far as the current event. All right.
See, a lot of people blow David Icke and people like that as crackpots, you know. And,
right. Well, there's certain things in which that I don't agree with David Icke on, but as far as this worldwide international sex ring, that is real. We've heard about that ever since the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
With, matter of fact, while I was in college, in the early 90s, we had a police officer, actually, I think he might have been FBI, in which that actually opened up his files to us about the satanic abuse and kidnap of children. It's while I was a member of the Lyceum Committee on Silver State University campus. I think I was the junior class president at that time also.
Man.
So he was telling us that this is actually what was taking place. So this is real.
Is he still in law enforcement?
I don't know. I mean, that was like the early 90s, like around maybe 92.
Yeah, 91, 92.
Right, it was around 91 when he came to FSU. And we was there listening and trying to find out exactly what was going on. It was between my sophomore and junior year.
Okay. Man, there's some really heavy, deep stuff going on around the world that people don't know about.
Oh, yeah. And so, like we said, we're going to see what's going to take place in the next 7 days to see how real this thing actually is, because they won't be able to hide the Pope or the Queen or anyone else, the Prime Minister of Canada or anyone else getting arrested. They won't be able to hide that.
So,
you know, it's not going to be possible to have that much blackout media, especially off the Internet. Something is always going to come through.
So they won't be able to control it.
Right, they won't be able to control this. I doubt that very seriously.
So you will be hearing about that on CNN or on the local TV stations, more likely, too, also.
Right.
That'd be the first time.
Yeah.
That would be the first time.
Yeah.
So they must be really, really losing their grip.
Oh, they definitely have. There's no doubt about it. The end is here, you know. Just like we were saying, you know, we heard Will Smith play Ali, you know, in the movie and saying the champ is here. Well, we done rephrase that and saying that the end is here, you know. And so this
exactly
was going on, you know. So one of the things that we definitely want to get into is higher sciences. And being that we're seeing the lower nature and the things in which that takes place with the utilization of the lower nature being the fact that we're not taught proper science of sex. For example, we're not taught about the science of the Kundalini and how to raise it in a micro or macrocosmic orbit up the crown, up the spinal column, up the crown, down the front of the channels or governing vessels. You have the governing vessel and the conceptual or functional vessel. The governing vessel extends from the perineum up the spinal column to the top of the head, basically, and then from the top of the head down the front of the body, the middle portion or middle half of the body, down back to the perineum is the conceptual or functional vessel. So here you have these two vessels or two channels in which they are active and open, or at least that's what they're supposed to be, so that this energy can flow in order to send forth the proper amount of prana or chi or ki energy, Holy Spirit, as we say, through the rest of the 12 meridians.
Mm-hmm.
When these particular channels are not open and activated, then disease or sickness and stagnation can set in. You know, diseases such as high blood pressure, diabetes, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, lupus, so forth and so on, because these particular channels are clogged up and the energy is not flowing properly. So there's a stagnation of energy in the body through these particular channels.
Mm.
And these channels are supposed to be freely open, you know, so that the energy can flow through properly so that there is no illness in which that takes place within the body. As a matter of fact, if these channels was open properly in the sex function, then what happens is that there would be no such thing as syphilis, gonorrhea, chlamydia, HIV, AIDS, or whatever else in which they say in which that attacks the immune system or attacks the sexual genitals. Many of these things would even exist.
Well, that comes in with the proper breathing still, doesn't it?
Hey, all of that is commenced on the breathing because that is what we do on a daily basis. There's nothing in which that we do more than breathe. You know, matter of fact, we can go without food for a month or so, without water for 2 weeks or so, but try to go without the breath for 3 minutes or so and see what happens. You know, as I always say, I got the phone, and I can dial 911 for you. You know, so this is what is, you know, taking place. You know, and until we understand that the science of breath is the most important thing, you know, and that this is actually spirituality. Breathing is spirituality. Now, I don't know what the concept in which that people think spirituality have to do with. They don't got nothing to do with no damn white robe, damn sandals on your feet, and you going around talking about you holding it in thou. I have nothing to do with spirituality whatsoever. Spirituality or spirit deals with the breath. You can look it up in Webster Dictionary. Look up the word spirit, you will see the word breath. It's synonymous to breath. Look up the word breath, you see the word spirit synonymous to breath. So
right.
One and the same, you know. And so when you learn the science of breathing, then you master the spirit, you know.
Right.
And the spirit controls the flow of prana, chi, or ki energy. You know, is the mechanism in which that is able to distribute these particular energies throughout the body. And we speak about the fact that there's three areas in the body in which that you gather this energy at. You have your navel chakra, you have your heart chakra, and you have your third eye chakra. All right, these three particular areas is where you store energy at within the body. If you want longevity, then you store it at the navel. If you want love, then you store it at the heart. If you want intelligence or high IQ, then you store it at the third eye. All right, so these are the sciences that we have to bear witness to as we grow in consciousness. And this is actually Christ consciousness, in which that has now come back upon the planet. And also the reason why, like we said, the Pope can't stand the energies. In other words, he claimed to be the vigor of Christ, you know, and the vigor of Christ is fihi dihi hi, in which that means 666, in which that is embedded inside of his tiara or his crown.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it equals up to. Now, you know, you can find this in a Catholic article in which that came out in the 1960s, if I'm not mistaken, around 1966, you know, the same year in which that Ronald Reagan or Ronald Wilson Reagan, 666 himself also legalized, you know, Anton LaVey to establish the Church of Satan.
Right. Yeah, I heard about that.
So,
mm-hmm.
So in this, you know, we now understand is that this end, as far as this domination over the planet, has now come to an end. You know, the followers, which is 1.2 billion Catholics, will have to begin to look elsewhere, hopefully look within, in order to find the Christ in which they really need to be looking for, their real Lord and personal Savior. And not looking at this cracker on the throne or this, you know, black coon Negro in which that is getting ready to be the next and the last pope. Hopefully they will not be looking at these individuals any longer, something outside of themselves, when actually the only place in which that God exists is within the body of God, which is the temple of God, which is the physical body itself, your own
right.
Anatomy, your own physiology. You know, this is where God dwells at, in particular within the pineal gland. The soul is embedded inside of the pineal gland. That soul is God. It is immortal, everlasting, forever, eternal.
I heard you mention Ronald Reagan as Ronald Wilson Reagan. Is that
right.
Wilson? Is that means he is a bloodline to Woodrow Wilson?
Definitely correlation. I'm pretty sure based on the connections being that most presidents are related to each other, and this is how they have dominated, you know, and put forth their New World Order agenda, is that they pass it on to cousin after cousin after cousin.
Uh-huh. Right.
You know, within the families.
Right.
Huh. You know, and this is how they control the political areas. You know, this is why they have these secret societies, such as the Skull and Bones, in which that was established in 1832 by William Russell, in which that gave them the ability in order to control politics. So anyone who has gone to Yale and have joined the Skull and Bones oftentimes get political positions in Congress, in the Senate, or House of Representatives, or even higher, the presidency. You know, here recently we know that George Walker Bush and George Herbert Bush, you know, father and son, basically double-teamed, you know, and, you know, essentially went back-to-back with Clinton in between.
Right, it sure was.
No, we come to find out that Clinton actually is a Rockefeller. Wilbur Rockefeller is his father, and he's the illegitimate child of Wilbur Rockefeller.
Man, ain't that something?
Yeah. So, you know, Nelson Rockefeller was the vice president. You know, if you go and you go do some research, he was a vice president.
Yeah,
you know?
I was looking at Ronald Reagan's birthday. Isn't his birthday the 6th of June?
Yeah. Amazing, right?
The 6th month, the 6th day.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he was born within the 6th hour of that morning.
Mm.
I'm not sure.
Right.
Now, I could be wrong, you know.
Right.
Don't quote me on that, but I got to look back on that.
All right. Well, that's still interesting info that everybody needs to do some research on. Right? I mean, all of these things are no coincidence. We all play a part with this, in which that is taking place on the planet, if you know it or not.
Right.
The more conscious you are, the more your thoughts permeate this plane of existence. Therefore, as the tides turn, your thoughts will permeate the resurrection of consciousness upon this planet. All right? You can't keep living a lie, as they say.
No. No.
You know, and that's what's going on. People have been complacent with living lies on this planet, and that is getting ready to stop. It has no choice.
Nigga, this is the age of truth. This
right.
is the Aquarian
age. Age of knowing. And so being in the age of truth or in the age of knowing, we have to come to the conclusions and to the acknowledgement, you know, of not just what is taking place externally, but what we must do internally in order to change that which is happening externally, in order to make things better for the world, you know, as we make ourselves better within. And we come to the ratification of our problems, you know, that we have with ourselves, the self-hatred, the low self-esteem, no self-worth, no self-love, all of these things, which are actually nothing more than attributes of fear, has to be eliminated.
Wow.
You know, so... as I was saying, that William Russell, who is the founder of the Skull and Bones at Yale, which is the second Illuminati chapter, we find out that John Curry was Skull and Bones.
Right.
We find out that Hillary Clinton was Skull and Bones. We find out that
Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
Hillary.
They said that she had connections with the Skull and Bones also.
Ah. Okay.
Yeah. As well as Al Gore. You know, so here it is that the Skull and Bones, regardless of who you have voted for, whether it was Bush or Al Gore, you would have ended up with Skull and Bones. Or either if you would have voted for John Kerry or Bush, you would have ended up with Skull and Bones.
So they got it all sold up.
Right. And that's exactly what that was being shown. And that was just within that one particular organization. You know, there's other so-called secret societies in which that maybe, you know, definitely not as popular as now as the Skull and Bones, in which that, you know, a lot of that information just been released, you know, over the last 10 years. But there was actual articles, you know, written on the Skull and Bones. Matter of fact, there was a Batman episode in which that Brother D'Lo Morgan, in which that put me up on from the Duke of Tears from Brother Asir, in which that showed that in the Batman episode, they was talking about, excuse me, but are you, you know, are you Skull and Bones?
Huh.
No, you attended Yale? I mean, all of this was in the Batman episode in the 1960s.
A lot of that stuff went over a lot of people's heads at the time.
Oh, that definitely went over everyone's head at that time, you know. And the fact that you had to go back and look at it, you can actually find that YouTube clip on there on YouTube. You know, you can find that clip there on YouTube. You know, so definitely go and check that out. Is that in the Batman episode in the late 1960s, here they are talking about Skull and Bones.
That was,
and I remember George Bush and John Kerry both was asked about their tie to Skull and Bones, and they said, well, we can't talk about that.
Right. Right. They sworn to secrecy.
Right, right. They said they can't talk about that. But there's been articles in which that have come out. Anthony Hiller speaking about the fact that they have to get in coffins. Matter of fact, there's a good magazine, too, in which that deals with his Ghetto Times magazine and Frontline magazine by Marcus Klein used to deal with that information. I think the Ghetto Times is still being written. At least they have an online bookstore or, you know, magazine information. You can still go and look that up, you know, Ghetto Times magazines. But basically what was said is that they wrestle, you know, here they are within coffins, and they have to masturbate as they tell their deepest secrets, you know, about their sexual, you know, escapades. And then when they get out, they have to go and get into the mud and wrestle each other, and then the one who pins who becomes their soulmate.
Man.
You know, so, I mean, these are the, once again, this goes back to this perverted, devious sexual behavior. And that if we knew the real science of sex, that sex is marriage, then we would have a whole different concept. Because the word marriage means to merge. And if you look up the word sex, you will see that the definition of sex is to merge. So the word sex and marriage actually are one and the same. They both have the same root, which is to merge. So sex and marriage are synonymous. We have become, you know, being the nation of hypocrites and heathens, you know what I'm saying, and having no traditions and having no culture, and actually we have a de facto culture based off the indoctrination and the training that we have received, you know, from a people in which they just got out the Caucasus Mountains, or out the caves and hillsides of the Caucasus Mountains, you know, just no more than 3,000 years ago. You know, and this is the nature in which that we have adopted, you know, which is lower nature, the lower self, the attributes of the lower self, the lower mind, you know. And so this is what is actually taking place and going on.
You know, I know that a lot of what I've heard also, that the Rothschilds have put the Rockefellers on their feet.
Right.
Had helped them buy a lot of equipment. They're drilling, oil drilling equipment and things of that, you know, that nature. And,
as a matter of fact, what we found out is that the Rothschilds actually sponsored and financed the Rockefellers for domination here within the Western Hemisphere as the Rothschilds controlled the Eastern Hemisphere.
Therefore, you know, the Rockefellers will never pay them off. Never can pay them off.
Well, remember, the The amazing thing is that the Rothschilds were actually the financiers or the bankers for the Vatican.
Ain't that something?
Yeah, they was the,
for the Vatican.
Right. That's how the Rothschilds got their money, was being the financiers or the bankers for the Vatican.
Because I hear that nobody really knows what the Rothschilds, how much finance the Rothschilds have.
Mm.
No one really knows.
Put it this way, M. Sure the Rothschild had over $600 trillion in gold in his basement when he was alive. Now you can take that and think about how much that is now. Mark up the value on that now. During the time when he was living, there was $600 trillion in gold.
Hmm.
In his basement.
Wow.
Because one of his puppets were Cecil Rhodes, in which that was getting the diamonds and the gold along with the De Beers from out of Africa.
Well, a lot of those trillion gold he got in his basement is ours anyway.
Well,
I would think.
Well, it comes from out of Africa. I mean, but that's the whole science of Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey wanted to, take us back to Africa, not just to live, but to be able to do the same thing in which that these other corporations and Europeans were doing, and that was to get the resources of the country so that we can finance our own infrastructure.
Right.
So he said if the oil is good for the Rothschilds, you know, and the rubber is good for the Fords, you know, and, the banking system is good for the Cockneys, you know, and so forth and so on. He said, then why not, you know, and how come, you know, the oil and the gold and the diamonds cannot also be good for the Negro? You know, be paraphrasing, but that's essentially what he said.
Right.
So he wanted us, he already squealed, you know, here it was in the 1920s, and Marcus Garvey knew who the Illuminati was.
That was a very wise man.
Right. He named them back then and said if the oil and the gold and the diamonds was good for them, then, shit, it should be good for us too.
Right.
So this is why he wanted to go back to Africa. It wasn't a damn just sit around and drink margaritas or daiquiris on the damn beach. You know, that's what Negroes think. Oh, he wants us to go back to Africa and just enjoy the life. No. And it's not what he wanted. Matter of fact, he didn't even want lazy Negroes. He wanted those who was highly skilled and educated.
He wanted them active.
Right, and who was active. And he was going to go, and that's who was going to go there in order to get the resources of Africa in order to utilize.
Wow.
I'm holding on a second here, brother. L, we have a call at 302, area code 302, you're on the line. Peace.
Peace.
Yes, peace. Yes, you had a question, a comment?
Peace.
Peace, Moore.
Peace, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Oh, pardon me. I stepped outside for a second piece. I just wanted to add on to the whole Skull and Bones issue.
Right.
There's a movie out. There's actually three of them. They're called The Skulls, 1, 2, and 3.
Right.
And
1, 2, and 3, that's right.
Exactly. It goes into a lot of the information that you just demonstrated a few seconds ago in regards to how them coming through that society by blood and then taking over politics or being associated with politics as well.
Right. Another good movie from the 1970s was The Bell of the Brotherhood of the Bell.
Mm-hmm. SS.
Brotherhood of the Bell. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely. Peace, Aline.
Well, peace, Zach. How you doing, Brother Messiah?
I'm all right.
Word.
You
anything
go.
Else you want to add on?
Nah, that's it. I just wanted to, add that on for the listeners out there and let them know to tune in, especially to part one. Part one goes to a lot of what you was mentioning earlier in regards to bones. And even when you was just saying about how they, have a soulmate and stuff like that.
Right.
they go into that too on
right.
the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, each member has their soulmate who he's supposed they supposed to be hand in hand with each other, make all their confessions to each other in a dungeon.
That's and right.
What happens in the movie is that the one guy, Caleb, that ends up getting initiated into the skulls, he wakes up next morning and got $40,000 or $20,000, something like that, some big number in his bank account. So, you know, he's all souped up. But his one of his roommates or his best friend, he was anti-skull and bones. And he
right.
was trying to concoct evidence to be able to create conspiracies against them to show the people what they was actually doing. And he ends up stealing the key to the lodge or the you know, the ritual room from Caleb's soulmate. And when he goes in there, Caleb's soulmate ends up catching him in there. And they, you know, they get to tussling and stuff like that. And he ends up dropping him off a ledge to the point where, you know, he's like paralyzed, but he ain't dead. So he calls his father up, who his father is like the Supreme Grand Commander. I don't know exactly what name they go by, but, you know, he's like the HNIC of the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he comes through, and when he comes through, he finishes them off. And then they hide the whole thing up using the police and everything.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Say, brother.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen a movie called The Good Shepherd with Matt Damon?
Nah, I haven't seen that.
That's another good one about the skull and bones.
The Good Shepherd? Right.
Yes, sir. Matt Damon. It's kind of an old movie now.
Right.
Yeah,
you seen
I checked
it out.
Dr. Alim? Yeah, I checked it out before. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah, with Matt Damon.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm
kind of broke that down.
Hey, thank you, Brother Messiah. Be getting ready to go to these other phone lines. They appreciate you coming on and adding to the bill.
Oh, no doubt, no doubt.
All right, we're going to area code 512. Area code 512, you on the line. Area code 512.
Oh, peace.
Peace,
what's going on?
How you doing?
Yo, is that Brother Raglan on the line?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I was like, yeah, he sounds familiar. Like, I've talked to him before. He's like on it. He calls in a lot, yo. Oh,
yeah,
peace
well,
to the brother.
Right now, he's co-hosting, so... be getting down to the bottom of some of these so-called high sciences unveiled, you know, and seeing what's going on behind the veil, as we would say. Yeah, you had anything you want to add to the information that we've been dropping on?
I was going to tell you some a real interesting thing with the Qigong, though, if you want to hear that.
Yeah, I mean, anything
sure.
in order to uplift what's going on.
I've been noticing lately, I've been able to see the chi.
Right. What's the
instead of just feeling it?
Want to do that?
Well, basically, I've just been looking, you know, just the same like you would as an aura. Because myself and my mom's always been able to see auras, and so it's basically the same thing. The teacher that I was talking about, because I'm doing these classes instead of just doing Qigong, because I just learned like one form. I've been like trying to integrate, you know, because I really want to go on that cruise. And basically the same technique that you would use to see auras, instead of just trying to look at, say, a particular object, try to see as if you're looking through it. And then, yeah, I've been able to see the Qi, yo. Have you heard that before?
Yes, I see it too.
Yes.
Matter of fact, actually, there's my massage teacher, and I was trying to hypnotize him, actually, with, you know, I don't know, you see my Caduceus, a new one I got. I was trying to hypnotize him, and what happened, I found out that I actually hypnotized myself, and then I looked at him. But it was crazy because I didn't just see a human being. Like, at first I saw, like, his skeleton, but it went, it looked like I was looking up at like a straight soul, yo.
What,
going past the skin and everything.
So you done did the x-ray vision on him?
You can do that?
Yeah, you can do that. I've done it before. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Nice. Well, I mean, he was a white boy, but I mean, he's a cool white boy. But I looked right past that, and I seen his soul.
Right.
And that shit was crazy.
Word. That's excellent.
But anyways, yeah. I mean, I would add on to the information, but I was taking a nap, yo. So, I was but
I had to know.
And peace to Brother Raglan doing his thing. And peace to you, Elaine.
Peace to you. Peace to you, God.
All right.
Area
peace.
Code 336. Area code 336. You on the line. Peace.
Peace.
What's going on, Brother Elaine? What's going on, Brother
Peace. How you doing, Doc?
Everything pretty good, brother.
That's all, too, about the good shepherd, too, where it talks about, well, they had a scene in there with their mud wrestling down to some secret on the ground joint. I just want to touch on that.
Right.
Yeah, go ahead.
And also, I just wanted to put it in there because it was talking more about the start of the CIA.
Right.
The Good Shepherd.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. And there's another piece I want to touch on too, man. It was about the Pope and him putting in his resignation letter. But
right.
I was checking out, man.
Right.
I was checking out the chart. On that day, Jupiter had moved out, and Saturn and Uranus had stepped in, basically. I don't know how to say the words on the chart, but, you know, when I noticed that everything was over to the right, but Jupiter was out of the picture.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. He put it in on that, right on that day, he put it in, and that's when Jupiter had, you know, basically stepped in.
Mm-hmm. Like I said,
you know, trying to share that with people how, you know, saying they chart everything, you know, with the cosmos out there, you know, a lot of us.
Almost definitely.
You know.
That's deep.
Yeah.
That's deep. Now, from the astrological interpretation, explain Jupiter to the people.
You know, that has something to do with Peter, Church of Peter. The Piscean age when Jupiter first came in. That's just some of the things off the top of my head. I had wrote some things down in there, but basically that was the reigning power of Jupiter. I forgot what all his attributes were pertaining with it, how we feel and as it moves in the chart. But I'm not too. I haven't got too far into getting into the charts like that, but I can understand somewhat how it, you know, controls everybody.
Well, that goes back to what I was saying in one of the last shows about the Pope not being able to handle the energy because the fact is that Jupiter symbolizes expansion.
Yeah.
You know, so the fact that it also symbolizes expansion as well as also the planet of gifts. You know, in other words, these particular gifts in which that is being rained down upon us, you know, who are now within Christ consciousness, they move from out the age of Pisces into the age of Aquarius, we're being bestowed with, like, what's happening within 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, which says that we're going to have the gifts of miracles, the gift of speaking in tongues, the gift of interpreting in tongues, the gift of discerning spirits, the gift of faith, the gift of knowledge, the gift of wisdom. You know, the gift of healing. So all of these are, you know, all the gifts which that is now being bestowed. And so he knows that because these gifts are being bestowed based on the astrological alignment and those events in which that is taking place, he won't be able to handle those energies. Neither will any government on this planet be able to handle what is getting ready to happen. You know, this is why they have all these other things just in case, such as you know, what we've been found as far as discovered in Georgia with over the, you know, with those so-called plastic coffins which they found there in Georgia, you know, over 40,000 of them, you know, as well as also trains in which that has, what do they call it? I guess you can have arrest, bracelets, bracket, they have leg brace and arm brace on these trains, and it's not meant for animals. It's meant for human carrying, carrier of human beings, I should say. You know, then, of course, we know about they want to do population control agenda and destroy 4.4 billion people off the planet, and all these different things. All these things, something which that are nothing more than feeble attempts, in order to stop, this Christ consciousness, the chemtrails, the GMOs, the fluoride in the water, et cetera. It's still happening.
Yeah.
And we bearing witness to it. So appreciate you, bro, for coming on and dropping that.
Okay, ain't no problem. Ain't no problem, bro. I have one more question right quick, bro.
Yeah, go ahead.
It was this event. I was messing with this chick. This happened a few years back. But I was messing with her. And after we got done, she caused me some problems before I had, black backslid that, messing around with her. And, man, it's like, can't really explain. It was like this piercing sensation. It's like hitting my heart. Saying like, man, like, what the hell are you doing back messing with her? We already learned that lesson. Time to move on. And I was hoping if you can, let me know something about this. I said to myself, that must be my soul or something that hit my heart shock or something. Because it was a sensation that I never felt.
Right. Well, it symbolizes the extension into your emotional body. And, of course, your emotional body is the one in which that what people refer to as the aura is actually your emotional body. That's the one in which it actually changes colors. And based on your temperament, we can tell what color or see what, color is being emitted from that particular emotional body or auric field. So being that that is, specifically dealing with the heart chakra in a sense, what you felt was actually, like you basically were saying was, I guess you can say you double talking with yourself. Here it is, one aspect, you did it, but then another aspect, you was like, why? And so that confliction, oftentimes causes pain within the heart,
wow.
Whether it's emotional pain or whether it's basically dealing with relationships, you can have the same thing dealing with a relationship. Even a more connected relationship, I think also it was the cut and tie of the emotional body too, or your ethereal cord in which that you would have become attached to her, but you chose not to. So that was cut. And that cutting feeling was also what you felt was that piercing feeling. You was trying to cut the emotional tie.
Okay. Wow. Appreciate it.
I appreciate you, Watt. Yeah, Eric 0561. Eric 0561, you're on the line. Eric 0561.
Peace, I believe.
Peace, how you doing?
Hey, this is Brother Henry.
Peace, Brother Henry.
Peace, God.
Hey, what's going on?
Brother
I just wanted to add on this book. It's called the Atlas Strong. They came out with a movie on DVD,
right,
about the Atlas.
Two. Exactly.
Yeah, part one and part two.
Mm-hmm.
Supposedly she got connections and ties with the same subject that you're on. And she really revealing everything, but she encoded it within her novel.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to see you go in on that. Novel is pretty big, like almost 2,000 pages on this,
Right. Well, the first time that I heard about Atlas Shrugged was actually from Todd Collins in the late 1980s. Actually, it was 1989 was when I heard
that.
Was when I heard about Atlas Shrugged. And, and the lady who, basically wrote that book, the thing is that she was dwelling on the establishment, like you said, was in a novel form, but she was detailing the events on what was going to take place. And Todd Collins spoke about that if you want to know the Illuminati structure and what they was going to do, he recommended that you read Atlas Shrugged.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so here it is, you know, part one and part two came out. Part one was advertised somewhat. Part two was not advertised. I didn't even know part two was out until maybe a month ago.
Right.
You know, so it was not heavily advertised. But for those who want to go and check out part one and part two, you can go to movie2k.to. That's movie, M-O-V-I-E, the letter 2 or the numeral 2, the letter K, dot T-O. So when you go and check it out, you can see part one and part two, as well as also the Skull movies, part one, part two, part three, and any other movie which that we're talking about, you can actually see them on there.
Right.
Now, dealing with this book, now you were saying that it's going to break down like the structural pattern.
Right, and what they're going to do next, like collapsing the trains, in which that you see within the movie how they wanted to collapse the trains, how they collapsed the airplanes, how they collapsed. Now, you notice, look how many, between 1980 to 2000, how many airplanes went under as far as the corporations and how many mergers had to take place. So that was part of the collapsing of the airplanes.
Right.
Amtrak is basically the largest railway system in which that, you know, they have become so large that, you know, basically they don't know what's in which that exists. And now they're talking about them, you know, restructuring and rebuilding the trains or having new trains in which that, you know, travel almost up to 200 miles an hour.
I've heard that,
You know, and I mean, they look like the Japanese ones, so the Japan, you know, the Japanese, the Europeans already been on those fast trains for, you know, for over 10 years, 15 years or so.
The
United States is still behind as far as on the on railroad, no structuring. They're still behind. You know,
now,
so about how they was going to collapse the various modes of transportation so that they can dictate policy through various corporations or who was going to be in the head position, and that's what is shown through the movies Atlas Shrugged, Part 1 and Part 2.
Yeah, and they make the movie seem like that the movie was like something that people won't go and get, you know, it's like a blah movie, no action really, you know, it's just drama, like, things like this nature where it's not very appealing, you know, to the lower subconscious. But, But as you watch the movie gets into some real serious espionage. You know, like there's a lot of things going on in play with that movie, you know. And I was like, wow, this is crazy.
Part one was off the chain. I haven't got a chance to, only seen portions of part two. I got to go back and sit down and analyze part two.
Right.
But part one definitely was on point.
Yeah. One other thing, me and my cousin was looking at the Wikipedia, you know, not to say that Wikipedia is definitely, you know, it. But, you know, when you punch in Sony, you know, Sony is worth $1 trillion, you know, but you will never really focus on that, you know, around Sony, Maxwell, TDK, RCA, and a lot of these companies fall right up under Sony, you know, but this, they nothing but like affiliates of this one huge company that's worth trillions of dollars, you know. I mean, so what they do is they kind of throw you off, like, okay, well, these are all these other production companies, but they don't really tell you the revenue, but then as soon as you click on Sony, Sony revenue is over $1 trillion. You know, that's outrageous to me. You know, like $1.2 or $3 trillion you know, if you can kind of go in with this whole, these production companies, how they produce it, you can see how they own all the rights, you know, reserve all the rights to most of these rappers and videos and movies and all this stuff. You know, these people dominate, you know, the whole industry. But to add on to that, brother.
Yeah, what is those out about it? We're looking at Sony. We're looking at Sony. We're looking at basically Sony, in which that, you know, bought out Epic, bought out different other companies, in which that now, also with Time Warner, you know,
mm-hmm.
With their paper, magazines, with their news media, TV channels, as well as also with their radio stations and companies. You know, so Time Warner is one of the definitely ones. You know, Michael Jackson, you know, got killed because he was able to own more than half of Sony. You know, he was a shrewd businessman. And unbeknown to, you know, Mariah Carey's former husband, you know, Mottola. He beat Tony Mottola at his own game, Michael Jackson did, and ended up owning more of Sony than he did as far as in shares.
Wow.
So actually, Michael Jackson owned Sony. And that's one of the reasons why he ended up getting killed. And plus, he was speaking politically about the oppression of black people. Not just in the music industry, but he also was talking about how we was not being taught our history properly.
Right. He started in on that there soon when he came back from Africa.
Right.
You know, he started going in on that. When I told my queen, I said, now that can be like right there, the feather that breaks the camel's back. You know, they're going to go after him on this. Because his name and what he carries is going to resonate with the people more than someone else, like as King, Dr. King, and Malcolm X, because, you know, folks really resonate towards this dude, you know. So they just had to get rid of him on that one. And,
right. So, there's really only a handful, you know, less than a dozen of corporations in which they actually owns, like you said, all of the media. We know that a lot of the media now is owned by Rupert Murdoch. You know,
I gotta look him up.
You know, and different other stations are owned by him, newspapers, radio stations, etc. You know, so we know that this is what is going on, the monopolization of the industry. All modes of media are being monopolized by a handful or handful of people. You know, so we know this definitely to be the fact, brother. Appreciate you, Brother Henry, for coming on.
Thank you, brother. Sharing Thank you.
All right, we got area code 540. Area code 540. You're on the line.
Peace, God.
How you doing, Dr. Alim? I'm a big fan of your show. This is the first time I've ever called in, but
appreciate
you,
brother.
kind of tell you about a little experience that I've been having recently. The thing about at nighttime, I can look over, like, I can be in my room and it can be pitch black dark, and I can look at the walls, and it seems like the walls are just moving. Like, I guess it's like chi or something. I can just, it's almost like I can see billions of particles and everything. Like, everything is just moving at constant time. So I was wondering, is that like me seeing chi, like the guy was speaking about earlier?
Right, that's exactly what you're seeing, brother, is prana. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The chi of key energy.
All right, and then another thing I want to tell you about, another weird experience I've been having with birds. Like, I'll see, like, blackbirds or crows, like, they just kind of flock to me. Like, I can be sitting on the front porch, and I'll see, like, hundreds of crows. like literally hundreds of crows. I just didn't count them fly over my head and like near my house or whatever. So one time I was sitting out where I had walked out and I was about to leave and get in my car, and I'm looking up in the trees and there's this weird white bird. I don't know if it was a eagle or an owl. I don't know what it was, but there were like some black crows like in another tree over. And like, I looked at this bird and it just gave me this weird like feeling. I didn't like the presence of that bird. So I just kind of thought this evil thought, I guess, in my mind, or just a negative thought towards the bird. And these crows just attacked the bird. Like, they chased the bird off. Like, for 5 or 10 minutes, they were just chasing this bird, trying to get it to get out of the area. So I just kind of, you know, maybe you had an opinion on what that could possibly be.
Well, oftentimes, crow symbolizes in the aspect of sickness or death.
Mm-hmm.
Are there anyone nearby which is dealing with some type of ailment or disease?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Normally when they gather in groups like that, that's normally what it symbolizes.
Mm-hmm.
But based on this pole shift, you know, we might have to come to another conclusion.
Yeah, I was reading somewhere that they were saying that, you know, crows can represent death. And then the movie The Crow, where Bruce Lee's
right.
son was in, it was talking
right.
about how crows can represent, like, people from the dead trying to come back and
well,
back
rather
to the
right
side
right.
And,
mm-hmm.
And right or wrong that that happened before. So I almost feel like it's like my ancestors or something kind of, you know, protecting me or something like that.
All right. Well, I mean, actually, in a sense, it could be symbolic to the fact of ancestral energy.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, why not? Because it is connected to the dead, and that
mm-hmm.
energy of the crow is symbolic to that.
Okay.
So, you know, it's a matter of interpretation based on those circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reason why I had to ask you, is there anyone around? And since there's no one around that's dealing with those type of issues, then it would have to be ancestral protection or force in which that is being watched. You know, they're watching over you, you know, at
mm-hmm.
this particular time, being that you were the only one within that area, you
yeah.
know, and you're not dealing with those type of issues. So. Definitely you can have to interpret it in that manner. When
okay.
we see animals, they always, we have to learn how to interpret nature.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, for example, back in the mid-2000s,
mm-hmm.
around 2005, I got arrested.
Mm-hmm.
And my cat killed a jaybird
mm-hmm.
and laid it at the front door.
Okay.
Now, for those who don't know that, jaybirds are also jailbirds.
Yeah. Well, they're
jailbirds.
Wow.
Right. So, my cat was trying to warn me mm-hmm. that I was going to get arrested.
Wow.
You know, so I went to the laundromat, and for some reason I didn't wash the last load of clothes. I mean, I washed them, but I didn't dry them. You know, I didn't dry, you know, I didn't dry it like I needed to.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up bringing them back, you know, to the establishment. And I was getting ready to go back out because I realized, man, these things, they're not dry as they need to be.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as I was getting ready to go out, here come the officer or the two, you know, undercover. Actually, I think they was bounty hunters, personally. I think they wasn't even sheriffs,
uh-huh.
you know. But they ended up arresting me, and that was symbolic to what was going on.
Yeah.
If I would have thought about, you know, the jaybird symbolic to the jailbird, then guess what? You know, I would have, you know, stayed in, didn't go out or whatever, you know, until that time would have passed or whatever would have happened.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, it's things that we have to start paying attention to in nature.
Right.
So the animals will you know, tell us, you know, what is getting ready to happen. You
yeah,
know?
I definitely have been trying to be out in nature a lot more, get more sun, and, you know, just
mm-hmm.
try to be outside as much as possible. But, yeah, that's the only thing I wanted to ask. I appreciate everything you're doing, man. Keep doing what you're doing. Peace, power, love to you, man. And you too, Dr. Brother L.
Peace and God. Peace and love, God.
All right, peace.
Love, I appreciate you. Thank you.
All right, peace.
All right, we got area code 111. This is out of the country, either unknown number here. So you're on the line. Peace.
Hey, what's going on, bro?
Hey,
I want to ask you a question. If I'm Caucasian, I want to know if I can be considered a Moor if I'm a...
If what now?
I'm Caucasian, I'm a white guy, and I want to know if I can be considered a Moor. I'm white.
Well, if you're white, you know, you can be considered what is called a tawny Moor. And if you go back and do your research, you will find out about the tawny Moors. You get the book Ancient Modern Britain by David MacReady, Volume 1 and Volume 2. He speaks about the tawny Moors, as well as also, I remember my wife and I was going to South Carolina, and we heard on the radio as we was passing through South Carolina, right after passing Florence, South Carolina, and going towards Columbia, that the news commentator, it was on one of the radio shows, you know, like, you know, one of the little radio shows, you know, with the little conservatives be on there talking this and that, you know, like the shows that come on right before Rush and all of them. But anyway, news commentator said that President Bush was a pouty mouth Moor.
Wow.
They call President Bush a pouty mouth Moor. And I was like, and I looked at my wife and I said, Queen, did you hear what I thought I heard? Did I hear what I thought I heard? And she said, yes. They said that President Bush was a pouty mouth Moor. And I'm like, oh, shit.
Wow.
A pouty mouth Moor. You know, just go back and do your research in history, and if you have that lineage or information coming from out of Spain, Portugal area, dealing with, Europe as far as sitting on the throne and coming through that bloodline and things like that, actually what they're talking about is actually coming through the bloodline of Hasenberg. You do your research on the Hasenberg, do your research on the Holy Roman Empire, and you'll see how that is different than the Roman Empire in which that, or the Roman Church, you know, that is there today. That is a de facto corporation. You know, really it's the Holy Roman Empire, in which that actually are the Coptics from out of Ethiopia, in which that expanded throughout Europe. You know, so just do your research and you find out if you're a white guy or not. All right. You got anything that you want to discuss before we get off of here?
Yes, sir. I want to comment on the European guy when he asked him, can he be a Moor?
Right.
So you were saying he'd be a tawny Moor. Would that be also derived from the Hasenberg family, also known as the Black Nobility?
Right. As if he can find those lineages. Right, exactly.
Okay.
Because we know that even Queen Elizabeth, you know, she is actually the great-great-granddaughter of Queen Sophia Stuart, who actually is known as Queen Charlotte.
Right, right.
You know, okay. And so since that is the case, you know, we know she was a Moor.
Okay, so that means that the Europeans were bloodline to Moors at one time.
That means that their bloodline is derived from Moorish descent. Right, exactly.
Right,
It was the Moors upon the throne of all of those particular bloodlines hundreds of years ago throughout Europe.
We known as Tawny Moors. Okay.
Right.
I got a better understanding.
Tawny Moors if that was the case.
Yes.
No.
Okay. Also, I like to talk to you after the show about some things I've talked about earlier.
Oh, okay.
Other than that, you say you're getting ready to sound off?
No. We still got a half an hour.
Oh, okay. I was getting ready to say that because I'm kind of early. Oh, okay.
Right. No. No, we're not getting off yet, you know, but I was saying if you wanted to, if you wanted to build on anything in which that, you know, that the guy asked.
Yeah, I also want to build on
that. You already answered that, so.
The thing, what he wanted to talk about, he's a white guy, thing about that term, that is a status.
Right. There's a difference within Black's Law Dictionary about a white person and a free white person. That's
right.
What I was trying to explain.
Okay.
Yeah, if you look at free white person, then that is someone who is from the Moorish lineage.
Okay.
It says Moorish inhabitants of Spain and Portugal. It's talking about the Sephardic Jews. Is also who actually are the Hebrews or Israelites descended from the Coptic or what is known as the Ethiopians, you know, the Falashians, Hebrews as they refer to as, as well as also many other places in which to throughout Europe in which it has that mixed blood or mixed lineage. That is who would be considered a free white person. It says
okay.
Specifically Caucasians and Aryans and Indo-Aryans are not, once again, I state, are not free white persons.
Okay, okay.
So if he said that he's white, in other words, if he's saying that he's Caucasian, then he's not a Moor.
Okay. Okay, I know what
lineage. He's not a free white person.
I know what Tosh Bay was saying at one lecture. He said, well, I'm a white man.
Right, but you've got to understand where you come out. Not a white man. That is incorrect. That
right.
is incorrect. All right? There is no such thing as no white man. That's fiction and law.
Right.
White is fiction and law. But we're talking about status. Now,
right.
when you say white person, it would tell you in there that white person is merely one who is distinguishable from a so-called person of color or black person.
Right.
You know? So it tells you right there within that definition. And it says that normally a white person is a Caucasian.
Okay.
Now, how is that possible? A white person is listed within the Black's Law Dictionary as being a Caucasian, but a free white person, it states, is not a Caucasian. So we know that that the free white person is a status, but it comes through naturalization.
Naturalization, okay. Okay, I got
right.
you. I got you.
You know, so that's the status within the confines of naturalization.
Right.
So this is what is, you know, actually talked about, you know, within the Black Law Dictionary. So people need to go and do their research and study on
all
that.
Right. All right. I'm definitely going to do mine. Yes,
right.
sir.
So if they're, you know, what he meant was that he's a free white person. If he's saying that he was just a white person, then I'm sorry. He can't be no white person.
Okay.
You know, and that is a problem
right.
with those words. That is incorrect.
Right.
You know, if you're not putting the word free in front of it, then you're not saying, you actually are saying that you're not a free inhabitant.
Right.
Or what is called free free in land or fee in land. You know, freeholder or free in land. You know,
right.
So if that is the case, then that's the problem, you know. And that's where the confusion comes in at.
Right, it sure does. It really does. I think you straighten that out for me.
Huh?
So I thank you for straightening that out for me.
Oh, no problem.
Yes,
because, you know, black folks going around, you know, Moors going around talking about they white people, you know, that is definitely doing a disservice to us. You know, we are indigenous.
Right.
Aborigines.
Naturally,
they are aboriginal to the landmass known as North America, South America, Central America, and the adjoining islands, as well as also to the whole earth, the globe. You know,
right.
When you look up the word land, as we have gone over before, you would see the word Moors embedded inside the definition. The word land, it comprehensive to be, or in general sense, what we call the dirt, as well as also the waters. You know,
right.
So the whole planet is land. Even the waters is actually land. This is how they was able to bring maritime or amorality law upon the land, is because they know the whole thing deals with the Moors. But they thought by keeping us under artificial statuses such as Negro, black, and colored that we've never figured out that we are the land.
Right.
This is why they use us, throughout the prison system. Over 65% of us is in the, of our people is in the prison, makes up the prison population. You know, this is why they use us as the major consumers. You know, because they're the ones in which that, you know, we are utilized in order to make money off of.
Right, to capitalize on it.
Right, to keep their system going. So since this is the case, you know, when it actually comes to the understanding, overstanding, and understanding of this, you'll find out that we're the ones in which that, you know, actually, I guess in a sense, this is all about. I mean, we're the ones in which that all this is about. You
right.
know, the whole controlling of the planet is at our demise of, and at our behest of keeping us down and keeping us oppressed, oppressed and depressed, so that we will not rise back up. This is the whole thing of the high Masonic and the Shriners, white Masonics and Shriners, as they call themselves, but pale, the pale man, as I refer to him as, in which that states specifically that they are supposed to suppress the rise of the Moors.
Okay.
That's what this whole thing was based on.
Mm-hmm.
You
but
know?
It's unstoppable. They can't no longer suppress us anymore like they really, really want to. When the time has come, you know, like I said, I keep saying it over and over again, they're requiring an age that's our age. Well, our age, the human race age, I'll put it that way.
Right. Well, I mean, Aquarius symbolizes Heru within the ancient Kemetic text, you know, and so Heru symbolizes the conqueror of the lower self, Set. So now it's time for us to graduate into the higher self concepts and attributes. That's the whole reason for this show is higher sciences, to show how we can graduate into those particular concepts, you know, and ideas, you know, and once again, like we said, was through the science of breath. You know, once you learn the science of breathing, you know, how to store prana, how to move prana, and how to project prana, then you become this ultimate vessel for this universal cosmic energy. You know, but
okay.
Until then, you know, we suffer the consequences, you know, of being controlled, mind controlled, you know, by this particular system, you know, through their subliminal suggestions, through their advertisement,
mm-hmm.
you know, through their symbolism and so forth and so on, become victims of it. And not realizing that, you know, we are victims.
Right. Like I said, I can't think of it. Devin Blair said it was to stop us now, like, an ant trying to stop a tidal wave.
Exactly. Trying to stop the ocean tide, exactly. So you're right. That is very just imagine that and see how crazy that looks.
That's what's happening to the Pope now.
Right, exactly. As well as also to the Queen and to the Canadian Prime Minister and et cetera.
And the church, the Vatican, the whole shebang.
The whole shebang, brother. No doubt about it.
Wow.
Yep. And of course, we know that the breath deals with the raising of the Kundalini energy, in which that opens
the area.
Did he?
Yeah,
it
did, but that was.
Yeah, peace.
Not unless you press the button
peace.
And by laying
peace.
The mail on it. I don't think so, though.
Okay, I don't know if he's able to hear us or not here.
Okay. They coming on?
Nah, I don't think so, bro.
Okay. Maybe something got mixed up somewhere.
Right. All right, well, as we were saying, we're talking about the Kundalini. And the raising of the Kundalini comes through the science of breath and those various techniques in which that raises up through the spinal column, in which that goes to the top of the head, in which that causes the unfolding of those 1,000 petals, what is called the lotus leaves or petals at the top of the skull, in which that means the activation of the pineal gland and the connection or the dendrites and the synapses connection between the left and the right hemisphere of the brain. So with that taking place, of course, we know that you have to deal with, you know, the science of mastery, you know, being also able to rotate the energy is probably the best thing, not just to do like the yogis and just raise it to the crown, but to do like the Taoists and circulate that energy, you know, throughout the body, and was that the rejuvenative principle, re-energizing principle, revitalized principle. Once we learn how to do that, then, you know, we can actually keep ourselves young as well as also keep ourselves mobile. As we said earlier, when the energy is going up and down and around, that's known basically as the Ouroboros, which is the serpent biting its tongue. That's the Greek name. The ancient Egyptian name is called the Uraeus or Caduceus, which that symbolizes the serpent of healing.
Right.
With that, of course, we see the medical symbol of the two serpents, which is symbolic to the yin and yang, or the activation of the Ida and the Pingala, which is known as the black and the white serpent, in which that goes up to the nostrils, the left and the right nostril, you know, and in which that once you learn how to do the alternating nostril breath technique, you activate the Ida and the Pingala. Within ancient Egypt, the Ida symbolizes Osset, Nephet, and the Pingala symbolizes Osset, which is Isis. So when these two are activated, the Kundalini energy can come up, which is another aspect of Osset, through the Shoshuna, which is known also as the Holy Spirit within the Christian teachings. So once we begin to start understanding these particular sciences, we know that we have to raise ourselves and at this particular time.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's dealing with the polarity of the energies.
Right, that's dealing with the polarity of the energies. At the base of the spine, that would be symbolic to Lucifer within your script, you know, hence the depths of hell. Lucifer is the Latin name, actually, for the Hebrew name, which is Uriel. Uriel is one of the, fallen angels, but he was still the seventh archangel over the depths of hell, in which that symbolizes the root or the base chakra. As he raises up, he transforms from Uriel to Samuel, to become Gimiel, to become Raphael, to become Azrael, to become Gabriel, to become Michael.
Exactly. Yes, I read it in your book, The First World Order.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, you sure do explain that. Yeah, you sure do.
Right, so as he becomes Michael, you know, that is the Christ principle. So that's actually the transformation of Christ from Lucifer to Christ. You know, and hence, this is the ascension or the resurrection. In other words, you know, transforming yourself from the son of man to becoming the son of God.
Right.
You know, like that, so that's why Jesus was known by both, the son of man and the son of God. Because it symbolizes the polarity of those two ends of the pole, the north and south pole. You know, in other words, symbolic to Set and Heru within ancient Kemetic teachings, which is known as the Djigid, which is the backbone of Osiris or Osor. You know, so, you know, these things just have to be mastered. You know, the breath. You know, these particular exercises can take up to 2 years. Nowadays, you know, in ancient times, it probably took the masters up to almost 20 years to master this information. But nowadays, anyone who practices Qigong or Tai Chi can actually become a master within a two-year span, you know, of how to move this energy.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I know you're talking about the circulation of the energies.
Right.
That means the circulation through the navel chakra, the heart chakra, the lung chakras, the throat chakras, and to the pineal gland and to the crown chakras.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
Right. Those are the seven endocrine glands. Right. The pineal gland, pituitary gland, as well as also the thyroid gland, the thymus gland, the pancreas, which also the spleen.
Mm-hmm.
The adrenal glands, which is the right, sit on top of the kidneys, the prostate gland, and the testes within the male, and the uterus, and the clitoris within the woman on ovaries. So those are the seven major endocrine glands in which that, you know, excretes hormones, you know, from these so-called ductless glands, you know, and once these particular glands produce these particular hormones, it's supposed to be in balance. When the body is out of balance, it produces illness or dis-ease or sickness.
Right. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. You know, I had thought about something to myself last night.
Mm-hmm.
And something I want to share with you and the audience. Remember when I told you about I went to court with the brother Yada?
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
And the police was trying to get me to take my fez off.
Right.
And they couldn't get me to take it off because I mm-hmm. explained that it was a religious headdress. It was mm-hmm. the fez, not a hat.
Right.
And I went to a second bunch of police officers. They wanted me to take it off. I said, no, it's a religious headdress. It's of my religion. It's a fez. So they, when I, Brother Hakeem Bey had explained to me, when I said the word religious headdress, that got him.
Right.
So that was automatically a lawsuit. But
mm-hmm.
as I was sitting in the court, in the courthouse, I thought to myself, I said, why? I said, I didn't see any police officers with their hats on. And I was wondering why. And I was thinking,
right.
I said,
you know,
no, they can't
wear military type of thing, Brother L, in which that, you know, when you go into a building, you remove your hat. So that's the reason why. As far as with us, you know, when we say religious headdress, we can wear our hats, as they would say, within those buildings. You know,
right.
Whether it's, you know, district or superior or, you know, federalized. You know.
Right. It also told me something else, too.
Mm-hmm.
I said, wow. I said, I did something the police can't do.
Right. Exactly. Right. Well, remember, based on the Black Store Dictionary, fourth edition, in particular, you look up the word more. It says, basically, officer of the Isles of Man who summons the courts for several sheddings. In which that one more basically is worth 100 bailiffs.
Wow.
Now, who are the bailiffs? The bailiffs are those sheriffs. Those bailiffs are, you know, are there to protect the judge in the courtroom. And it says that one more basically is worth 100 of them.
Hmm.
Mm-hmm. So definitely you was able to do what they couldn't do.
Now, so that shows that we have a certain power that they don't have.
Right. Well, the thing is that they know who we are, but at one time we didn't know who we were. So now that we're awakening, now they want to challenge us and see how much we know. You know, and that was the prime example of what I've told you took place when my wife and I went to England, and we went to the United Grand Lodge of England, and the curator of the museum was following us around asking us questions. He wanted to know how much did we know about us being Moors and our heritage.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and us being Aborigines from not Africa, you know, 400 years ago, but from right there within the Americas.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they say Maghrib Al-Aqsa, Morocco extreme to the west.
Right.
Because we look at Morocco being a part of North, well, you might as well say Northeast Africa.
Right,
instead
right.
of Northwest Africa, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
That's right. Not.
All right, well, we get ready to head out of here.
Okay.
I appreciate you for coming on, being my co-host tonight, Brother L.
Oh, always.
You know, Grand Sheik, Professor L. And definitely we'll be back here next Wednesday.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about
what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intentions straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.